Hey everybody, thanks for being here. Today we're out of Westport, Washington, going after Chinook salmon with John Keizer from Salt Patrol. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned.
I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. Today, we're on the Salt Patrol boat heading out of Westport Marina about halfway up the Washington coast for a day of Chinook salmon fishing. Today's conditions look great for John Keizer, who's joined by Steve Lynch at Procure and his friend Jerry Henderson. We have everything we need on board, so it's just a matter of finding some biters.
Steve, we're going to head out. We're going to go over the bar just a little bit north, about what they call about 04, up towards the casino. And we're going to head out to about 180 feet of water. That's where the kings have been. So get out there and start trolling about 100 feet on the riggers, and hopefully we'll get some nice fish today.
Right on. I'm excited. Never done this one before. So.
Oh, yeah. Westport's a fun place. It's definitely a fishing town, as you saw as you went through there.
So. Yes, it is.
Yeah, weather-wise, it looks like a pretty good day. It's going to be nice, and wind's not supposed to come up till later this afternoon, so we should have a pretty good day of fishing. Okay, so we're going to start out. I'm going to run some bait this morning. Jerry's going to start out with a cookies and cream spoon, put that out, and go down. We're going to probably fish around 100 feet and see what happens here. Get things rolling. I got to grab some herring. So I got a Procure dyed herring here. I'm just going to go ahead and do what we call a choked herring. So don't use a helmet. Just bring it through the mouth, come back through the side. And then the trick here is pick up that little flap right on there, bring your line up through there. That'll actually hold it in tight. That's it. You're ready to fish.
This one will go down 90. The fish out here have been anywhere from 80 to 120, it seems like. And because it's early in the morning, I'm gonna kind of stay on the shallow side. We've drop our flasher back 15 to 20 feet and then attach it to a, we use a pro release. Hold that with a tensioning knob down, lay it in there, and we wind it on around the bobbin. And we do it in a counterclockwise motion, and then it snaps in. Now when a salmon will bite that, this is your main line, if he's there, and it'll pull it off of this clip, and then it's just you and the salmon.
So we do it a little differently out here. When this goes off, instead of grabbing the rod, what I want you to do is come over and just reel. Okay. Just reel as fast as you can on the reel. Pick up the slack and then go ahead and pick it up and go.
Okay.
So, because the way these things will grab bait, they'll come up and just that thing will do this, and then it'll pop, and you want to reel on right away, and that'll help get that hook set in there.
Okay.
So the back rod, we put a diver on, and basically we set it up just so it goes under the motor. The wake of the motor, that motor will track fish. We get kings and coho on here, but can't keep any coho this year, but you'd be surprised how many big kings will come up looking for a meal in the morning and snag that thing.
Right on.
Yeah. So this we set pretty loose. We want the drag to just barely hold it, so it's got enough time to trip it and turn and grab it. So we're just coming up on the bottom of the tide right now. So low tide is going to be 30 minutes or so. And then we'll have the incoming, so this should be good fishing from here to here. Usually get a little bite in the morning, and then the afternoon tide will pick up. Well, so we're marking a little bit of bait here, about 70 feet sitting in there. It's right at, yeah, about 79 feet. So probably a little ball herring. That's been kind of what we're looking for. You see that, and normally the fish will be right around it out here because they're pretty aggressively feeding when they're in the ocean. So we're in the right place here. Just got to get them to go.
This is the rear rod. It was just on a diver. It's pretty shallow. So it's probably just a coho, which I'll have to go back. But any fish is better than no fish.
Well, you got to get the day started somehow.
That's right.
That's a pretty good sized coho.
He likes right back there. Nice and mellow.
Nice hook, good. Good shape. So what you don't want to do is handle them at all. So I'm just going to... Probably about 8 pounds. I'll just grab that hook right there. Let him go. Okay, so this year we have a coho restriction. So we're not allowed to keep any coho at all. So in Area 2, which is this marine Area 2 at Westport, no coho, but we do have 2 kings a day. So we can keep 2 king salmon. There's been a lot of nice coho. We have to just kind of be careful with them and turn them loose. If we get into a bunch of them, we usually just get up and move.
Sure.
So it's kind of a restricted area. They had a weak return last year. So part of the negotiation was a shorter season and no coho retention. So it's we're just all dealing with it this year, but you know, it is what it is. So.
And how have coho been out here this year?
Coho, been a lot of coho out here. So yeah, we've had to move several times to get out of them. So there's been some nice coho. A lot of hatchery coho too.
Yeah.
Welcome back to Westport, Washington. I'm Justin Wolf. So far, we've released a coho, but it's the kings that we're after, so maybe a change in tactics is what we need.
The ESPN boat right behind us just hooked up, so they were using basically a spatterback hoochie, so we're just going to go ahead and switch over to this one here. So we've got some croak here in here. We put a little bit of a herring tail in there on the top hook, and we get a little extra movement and see how that works out for us.
Here we go.
All right. A little bigger coho.
Yeah. Sorry, coho.
That's a little pink.
Yeah.
What's this? Oh, he's short. He's a short king. We'll release him just like the coho.
Got a little more weight to it.
Well, we're getting in the right species.
That's right. You just need to find
just
the
bigger
one.
Got to work our way up to Grandpa here. Well, they definitely want the hoochies. I think they like the sauce too. The tuna sauce might be the getting them going here. Okay, so what we got there was just a short, we call it a short Chinook. Basically any Chinook salmon, king salmon under 24 inches is considered a short. So we just go ahead and release them, go after the bigger ones. So get after the ones work, throw a little bit more of the super sauce on here and see if we can get another one to bite.
Tuna is a great all-around scent. I mean, it's primarily the salmon feed on the juvenile tuna when they're out in the ocean, but just in the blood, it's just got a really heavy oil concentrate. And so all species like the steelhead, the sturgeon, the walleye, they all seem to really just like the tuna here. That's probably one of the best scents for kokanee as well. And shoot, a kokanee's never even seen a tuna. So tuna's a great all-around scent. Works extremely well on all fish.
Oh, we got a report, bites happening about 4 miles north of us here, so we're gonna get the floor. Put the pedal to the metal and run up there. So, Evan Rude made a touch control now, so it's a touch throttle, so you can actually control your speed with the button right here. It's really nice, you can regulate your speed exactly, so I got shifter here, and then I can actually get to fine tune it right here. Got it on the autopilot, which makes for a perfect troll. Let me get the gear in the water. So we moved about 4 miles north from where we were. A little bite just took off up here, so guys are starting to get some fish. So we're gonna go ahead and get our gear in the water and see if we can catch up with them here. So
we're going 91. That's been a lucky number in the past, I guess. For no reason whatsoever.
So we're coming in a big bait ball here. It's all the way from 60 feet down to 130. So that's a good sign. That's usually where these fish are gonna be.
This one feels much better.
Yeah, that's a better fish. Yeah. We'll have everything out of the water here in a second, so.
Just clearing the other lines in the water. I think he's got a nice fish on there, and we don't want to mess up and get tangled up with another set of gear.
Okay, so that one was down 120 feet, and actually I just switched over to the
hoochie.
Yeah, the other hoochie. So we had a pair of purple haze on there, and put some tuna sauce on it, and bam!
Didn't take long.
No, didn't take too long at all. Oh yeah, nice fish, Steve. I don't know, he ain't all that big. But it looks like he might be legal. He's gotta be 24. He's legal though, so let's go ahead and put him in. There you go. All right, got the skunk off the boat this morning.
That's right.
Good job, my friend.
Not a bad fish. It's about the average size of a coming to run spring Chinook.
Probably where he was headed. Okay, so what we're using here is we got an 11-inch Pro-Troll flasher. It comes down, attaches, got a McMahon swip behind a ball bearing. That's kind of the standard. This is a golf tee. It kind of keeps stuff from getting in there. So then you go to your flasher, and then down below it, you got another ball bearing swivel to clip to another ball bearing swivel. Then this is 50-pound leader. All the way up to our squid here, or hoochie. And then our hoochie is just basically made up of, this one's called a purple haze. And as we go in, we got a couple of 5-aught hooks tied in it. And we got a little twinkle skirt insert in it and a piece of yarn. The yarn just helps hold the pro cure in there. A little bit of scent lasts a little bit longer. And then we got a little glow bead on the back. And that's pretty much the way it works. And as this works through the water, it's actually the flasher rotates it around. And that noise that the flasher makes is what attracts the salmon to it. And then they'll be back there, and they normally, if you notice how we got a rig with the hook hanging back just a little bit, they normally come in and they don't grab it from the back, they'll hit it from the side. And a lot of times they'll miss that front one, so they end up getting the back hook, which is exactly what happened on this last fish, so.
We've landed our first keeper Chinook of the day out of Westport, Washington with John Keizer of Salt Patrol, who's fishing with Steve Lynch and Jerry Henderson. These ocean fresh salmon are premium table fare, but it's important that the fish be handled properly after they're caught.
I put this rope through the gill plate there, and what we're going to do is hang it over the side and cut his gills and let him bleed out. So we have a hook here on the boat. Just hook it in. See, the way I do it, I just cut right through there. And they bleed really, really fast there. And we'll leave him in the water until we think he's bled out, and then we'll just put him in the box on ice.
So this year, weather's been kind of a factor. We've had quite a few days where we haven't been able to fish. In fact, we lost a week. Plus the season's been shorter, so where we normally start fishing the beginning of June and we fish all the way to the end of September, our season was 1 July through 21 August, which is in about a week. So we had a very short season, no coho retention, all we could keep is kings. And then you start throwing some weather days in there, it's made it kind of tough. Plus the kings this year have been really finicky. They seem like we'll get a good bite for a day and you know, do really well on big fish, then they're gone. And then you got to go a couple days, you're kind of struggling, picking one up, here up, and then you get another one, and then towards the end of the day, today we're hoping, you know, it's been an afternoon bite. For whatever reason this year, the afternoon seems to, they kick on, and you know, they start seeing more fish action around, you know, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in that time frame.
On Jerry's rod, I just put the anchovy super sauce.
Yep. This was at 102 feet down on the wire.
Oh, he's getting airborne. Yeah, what you normally do is you'll see Jerry do, when those fish come up and start windshield wiping, jumping out, flailing their head around, you want to stick your rod in the water. That changes the angle of the gear to the fish, and you'll stop it. He'll actually dive back down, keep his head down, so.
Hello.
ate that spoon.
Okay, so this fish just stopped bleeding. I mean, we just got him bled out. So now we'll go ahead and put him in the Yeti. And we like to keep some ice in there. I'll put a little bit of water in there. And it'll keep nice and cold. It'll be ready to eat, so. I'll go ahead and start the process on the next one. So there's many sizes of Yeti coolers. I have the big ones I use a lot of times, but this 105 is perfect for several reasons. One is the fish fit in it. It's deeper, so it's got a lot of volume. And then the best thing is, it's perfect height to sit on. So when you're sitting here watching the rods, everybody likes to sit on the Yeti. So you might notice I have two Evinrude 250s on this boat, G2s. A lot of people think that's overpowered. Really, they weigh about the same as 150s as other companies' motors, and they're you got all that extra power, but the fuel economy is way better. So being a two-stroke, you know, you don't have to worry about changing the oil, you don't have to do anything, you know, they just run them, and I get average probably 20% to 30% better than a normal motor would get. All right, so I've saved, you know, a lot of dollars when we run out here, especially when we're running for tuna, where we're going, you know, round trip 110 miles or 120 miles. We don't burn a quarter less fuel than we used to burn. Taking line, Steve?
Yes, sir. I feel the head shakes. There's got to be a better one. I'm hoping and praying anyways.
Well, this will be the third fish on the boat. But out here in the ocean, party fishing's allowed, so you can, the same guy can catch all the fish. It doesn't really matter, so it's perfectly legal. That'll work. Yeah, that definitely. If he starts doing the thing, shove your rod in there. Okay. Well, that's a nice fish. That's a good one.
Down on him.
Ready?
Yes, now.
Very nice.
Are we in the bag?
Yep.
Okay.
Welcome back to Westport, Washington, where we've changed locations, and it looks like that move is paying off.
Oh yeah, that'll work. That's a little better. You're getting there, Steve. You keep working up the chain.
Sure, you gotta start somewhere, right?
I like it. That was on the purple haze again.
Thank you, Lord, man. Please have another.
Good. So, got that one at 120. Go right back. Give him a little of that tuna and see if he hits again. As far as the salmon being in one location, they move around, they're coming through in schools. You gotta remember, all these fish are coming down the west coast and they'll be on different lines, and the line is like how many feet. So like right now we're in 170 feet. They could, tomorrow they could be at 220 or 300 feet. And the majority of these fish are going to the Columbia River. So we're just intercepting them. And it depends on what group of fish is coming through that day, and somebody finds them on that one of those lines, and then we know where the fish. Okay, so you notice I'm using green herring. So this is cured, this is frozen herring, green label, and there's some red label in there. And to get them ready for fishing, I like to have a little pop in them. So I use the Procure brine and bite. So this stuff's real easy. You just shake it up, take it, dump it in a bag, and go ahead and dump your frozen herring in there, put them in the refrigerator overnight, and they're ready to use. Well, trolling speed out here, as you can see right now, we're doing 2.4, but we'll go all the way up to 3. But what really indicates the correct trolling speed here is we look at our downrigger wire. So we want about a 45 degree angle on that wire. That means that the gear is working properly. So if it's out too far, we slow down. If it's down too far, we speed up. So that way it's consistent whether you're going against the current or going with the current. And a lot of times going with the current, you're actually gonna be trolling faster than you think. We might be doing, going down the hill with the current, we might be doing 3.1. to get the same angle on the downrigger, but that's the key thing, is to look at the wire.
Looks like we've got another one. This one seems to be the best so far. It's peeled off a ton of line.
We were using a spoon that time. It's cookies and cream.
And we have an anchovy jelly on it from Procure. Picked it up and took off. Feels good.
Oh, he's up. He's on top. You got it? I'll net this one if you want to drive. Alrighty.
Yes, sir.
Got a little head shake going on there. The moderate action rods like that, man, they give you a good fight. They really work well for downriver fishing. Yeah. Like a little girth down there. Yeah, it acts like a nice fish. Oh yeah.
You want to swap places with
I'll back up.
Oh yeah. Here he comes. Flasher's up. Oh yeah, that's a good fish. Oh yeah. That's more like what we came for.
That's what we're after?
That's what we're after, right there. There you go.
Yeah, very nice.
More like a Westport fish.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
All right. Good deal. Good job. Yeah, spoon nailed that one. Cookies and cream again.
Yes.
I mean, wow.
Very nice.
So they're eating on the, they're liking the spoons today.
Hey, thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, the show would not be possible. So please thank them when you can. Now, get out there and do some great fishing.